Okay, we're studying the parables of Jesus. We're doing this on the heels of our study of the Sermon on the Mount. And when you study the Sermon on the Mount, you study the parables, you have a large chunk of the Lord's teaching. And this morning, I hope to complete the introduction that I began 3 weeks ago, which was the last time we met. Now, you'll recall that the kingdom of God, this concept, this idea, it was central to Christ's ministry and message. I had a number of quotes, but in the words of the late theologian George Ladd, just to give you an example, he says in his New Testament theology, modern scholarship is quite unanimous in the opinion that the kingdom of God was the central message of Jesus. And Jesus' parables, they all focus on various aspects of the kingdom. Even those that don't seem overtly to do so are focusing on different aspects of discipleship within the kingdom. And you'll see that as we go through. And to repeat the quote from David Wenham, Wenham is the fellow who taught New Testament at Oxford for 24 years. Wenham says, "What are Jesus' parables all about?" The simple answer to that question is that they are all describing some aspect of the kingdom of God. The central message of Christ is the kingdom of God. The parables shed light on that concept. The simple answer to the question, they're all describing some aspect of the kingdom of God. The kingdom of God was the central theme of Jesus' preaching and indeed of his whole ministry, and the parables should all be seen and understood in that context. So it's helpful. In fact, I would suggest to you it's necessary to have some understanding of the kingdom of God as background for studying the parables. And that's what we were talking about 3 weeks ago when we ended. And I'm going to pick back up. I'm going to remind you of some of the things that I said then. I always feel I have to do that. I'm going to remind you of some of the things that I said there. I'll try to do that quickly because I know this is particularly painful because I went through a lot of this before the Sermon on the Mount. But I explained 3 weeks ago why I'm doing it again. But I'm going to review that quickly and then we'll pick up from there and go on and hopefully be able to finish the introduction to the parables today. God creates in Genesis. We have this creation, this very good creation. Over 6 days, God creates it. And that very good creation, it was spoiled soon after creation by the introduction of sin into the human world. And as a result, God's creation is not now the way it's supposed to be. It was spoiled. It was corrupted. It's no longer a paradise, see, where all things work together in peace and harmony under God's rule. Instead, our world now includes, and this comes as no surprise to you, our world now includes hostility and alienation and fragmentation and suffering and sorrow and death and decay. In that sense, our creation is a creation that is sick as a result of sin. And the story of the Bible, it is a coherent story. It is not simply isolated things. The story of the Bible is the story of God's work through the people of Israel to rescue his creation, which includes mankind, but it's his work to rescue his creation from its fallen state. That's the whole story of the Bible. People are the high point of God's creation. They're the high point, but his rescue effort, it includes all of creation because all of creation was harmed and affected by sin. And you see that very clearly in Romans chapter 8. You can see it in Genesis 2 with the curse. But all of creation, sin had that large of an effect. So God is here rescuing creation from the harm that has befallen it as a result of sin. Now, God is and he always has been sovereign. He always has reigned in absolute supremacy over his creation. But since the fall, since the introduction of sin into the human world, there's a sense in which his kingly rule, his sovereignty, is not being fully expressed or fully asserted or fully manifested. He's sovereign. He's on the throne. But he's allowing creation to go on out of step with his ultimate intention for it, to continue in a state of sin and suffering that is contrary to his ultimate purpose and vision. So here comes this corrupting thing that comes into his very good creation. God is working to redeem this creation, but in the interim, he's allowing creation to go on out of step with his ultimate purpose and vision, with redeemed creation. So he's not fully asserting his sovereignty in that way. And I think that's an important thing to grasp and to understand. The prophets, you see, the prophets saw that a day was coming when God would express his sovereignty and his rulership of creation. He would express it in such a way that all things would be brought into harmony, would be brought into conformity with his ultimate will and purpose. He would assert his sovereignty to heal the sick creation. And the prophets saw that day. And we talked 3 weeks ago about some of the ways they expressed it. They expressed it all in ways that had meaning to an ancient Israelite, that God was going to do something to set all things right. He was going to act to the blessing of his people. His creation would be redeemed from the dreadful consequences of sin that had invaded it. This world of rebellion, this world of sin, hostility, alienation, fragmentation, it would be rescued by God. This fallen creation would be transformed by God into a true utopia, a perfect reality of love and joy and complete and absolute fellowship with God and one another. No suspicions about each other's motives or love, just a perfect existence that God is going to come and do that, you see. On that day, God would fully and powerfully manifest the sovereignty that he already exercises over the world. He would exercise through his sovereign power, he would bring creation to its ultimate fulfillment, to that true utopia, the state in which God fully asserts his sovereignty so as to heal the sin-sick world, so as to redeem the world from the consequences of sin that invaded the human world, is what is meant by the phrase, the kingdom of God. It is God's reign expressed as the divine utopia, the redeemed creation in which there's no more death or mourning or crying or pain. That is the vision. That is what God is doing throughout Scripture. He is working to take the sin-sick world and redeem it and rescue it so that he is the victor. And then creation goes on for eternity. You see, that's the picture. Let me read to you what Darrell Bock, he's a New Testament scholar. Darrell Bock says in a 2009 book, The Historical Jesus, Five Views, he says, although the kingdom of God is not a common phrase in Hebrew Scripture, the idea that God rules is a frequent concept within it, within Hebrew Scripture, and Second Temple Judaism. However, this concept as Jesus used it is not about the inherent sovereignty God has as creator. You see, he's always on the throne, always sovereign, but he's allowing creation to go on. So what is the kingdom of God as Jesus? He says, rather, it treats the idea of his promised redeeming rule expressed afresh in the world in the arrival of a newly dawning age of shalom, age of peace, age of harmony, age where everything is brought back into order. You see, this is the kingdom of God. This is what he's after. He says the kingdom vindicates the righteous and brings ultimate justice. Well, when the Old Testament ended, this hope was not fulfilled. Yes, they came back from Babylonian captivity, but it didn't match what the prophets had shown. You see that? It wasn't fulfilled then, and it wasn't fulfilled in the intertestamental period. the centuries between the close of the Old Testament and the arrival of Jesus Christ. In the first century, what do we see? Israel is weak. Israel is poor. Israel is under the rule of pagans, the Romans. That's their state. And the people, they longed and they prayed for the coming of God, for the coming of His kingdom. Come, come. This is what the people wanted. This is the hope of humanity. That God would act to intervene, to rescue and redeem His creation. This is what people have been after. This final intervention when He would set all things right. And He would rule to the blessing of His people. In Mark 15, 43, Joseph of Arimathea, he's described there as one who was what? Waiting for the kingdom of God. What's he doing? He's waiting for the kingdom of God. He wants the intervention. He wants God to come in and redeem and heal and fix this broken creation. Now, it's into that religious, this is right where we ended last week, it's into that religious, social, and political environment, with all of this history that's going on, it's into that circumstance that Jesus comes saying, the time is fulfilled. The kingdom of God is at hand. It's into that circumstance that Jesus comes saying, but if it is by the Spirit of God that I cast out demons, then the kingdom of God has come upon you. It has come upon you. You mean what we've been waiting for? What mankind has been longing for? You're saying that the kingdom of God has come upon us? Yes. That's what the Lord is saying. And He says, and for behold, the kingdom of God is among you, is in your midst. Jesus was announcing the arrival of God's final intervention in history, this ultimate expression of His kingly rule on the world. You see, this good news of the kingdom, Matthew 4:23. Jesus went throughout Galilee, teaching in their synagogues, preaching what? The good news of the kingdom and healing every disease and sickness. Matthew 9:35, Jesus went throughout all cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the gospel, the good news of the kingdom. And healing every disease and every affliction. I must preach the good news of the kingdom of God to the other towns. Why? Because that's why I was sent. He was sent to preach the good news of the kingdom? To make this announcement? Hey, there's news. Something's taking place. Yes, that's why He was sent. Luke 8:1, Jesus went through the cities and villages proclaiming and bringing the good news of the kingdom. Luke 9:2, Jesus sent out the 12 to what? To proclaim the kingdom of God and to heal. 9:60, Luke, leave the dead to bury their own dead, but as for you, go and what? Proclaim the kingdom of God. The good news of the kingdom that is to be proclaimed, that is to be announced, was that at long last, after all of this time, all of this waiting, all of these years, all of these centuries, at long last, the kingdom was arriving in the person and ministry of Jesus. The kingdom is arriving in the person and ministry of Jesus. He is the kingdom bringer. That's the announcement. That's the news. That's why He tells the disciples in Matthew 13:17. For truly, I say to you, many prophets and righteous people longed to see what you see and to hear what you hear and did not hear it. They were waiting all through the centuries. Come, heal, intervene, the kingdom, fix it, set it right. And here comes Jesus saying, the kingdom of God is among you. You see, this is what they, and He's telling them, it's happening here and now in me and in my ministry. That longed for thing. They looked for it. You're looking at it. You're looking at it. And this is what Jesus is telling them. Now, this naturally created excitement in some quarters, but it also created suspicion and opposition in others. It also led to misunderstanding. because of some incorrect ideas the Jews had about the coming and the nature of the kingdom of God. They had built up certain ideas and expectations about the kingdom. When Jesus comes and announces the kingdom, well, they've got certain ideas and they're not matching. And they have some wrong ideas, and Jesus is going to set about correcting some of those. See, many of the Jews thought the kingdom would arrive through or in conjunction with human military conquest, or more specifically, through or in conjunction with the expulsion of the Romans and their supporters from Palestine. You remember John 6:15, where it says some were about to take Jesus by force and to make him king. Well, see, in their mind, it was in his role as a political king. That was the role. It was in that role that he would be the means or the catalyst of the kingdom's arrival. That's how they understood this to work. So he's going to become as a political king, and through that process, the kingdom will arrive. So you had some people who looked at it that way. That expectation lies behind Peter's rebuke of Jesus when he spoke about going to Jerusalem to die. Peter's like going, that's crazy. It didn't fit, see, his concept of who Jesus is, given his notion of the kingdom. It lies behind his drawing his sword in an attempt to fend off the arresting crowd in Gethsemane. But you see, Jesus had something different in mind. He had something bigger, larger, deeper, richer in mind. And so he had to correct that. Now, the Jews also expected the kingdom to come suddenly and decisively. They thought God's final intervention would be a one-shot deal. The day of the Lord. You see, the day of the Lord would come where the old age would be terminated abruptly. And the new age, the glorious new age that they envisioned, this time of shalom, this time of healed creation, that would come. It would be this one-shot deal. You remember in Luke 19:11, where the people supposed that the kingdom of God was to appear immediately upon Jesus' arrival in Jerusalem. This is how they viewed it. This aspect of their thinking has been diagrammed by many people. I like this diagram. I took it from David Wenham. And it looks like this. This was the Jewish expectation. Is that we have the old age, this current fallen, sick, alienated, fragmented world. We have the day of the Lord, and that's all done away with. And then we have the new age. We have the divine utopia. We have this healed creation. That was their concept. That's what they understood, and that's how they thought about things. And Jesus will challenge that. Well, you can see how that caused people to wonder. How could Jesus be ushering in the kingdom of God when the hallmarks of the old age, death, decay, suffering, hostility, sin, fragmentation, when all of those hallmarks were still present? Given this concept here of the kingdom, where that when you have the kingdom arrive, that all of that's done away with, and then we just go into the eternal state. Jesus is saying the kingdom of God is among you. The kingdom of God has come upon you. They're going, well, how then do I still see death and all of this? Murder, slaughter, everything. Why do I still see the hallmarks of the old age if you are ushering in the kingdom of God? Because doesn't ushering in the kingdom of God mean the end of that? Right, this is what a lot of Jesus' teaching is about. He's correcting some of these ideas that people have. You remember how even John the Baptist began to question? As he sat in Herod's jail, he began to question whether Jesus was in fact the one who would bring the kingdom of God. You can see, right? I mean, he's sitting in here. He's under the authority of this pagan guy. This person doesn't care a thing about God, and he's rotting away in this jail. And here is the kingdom bringer on the scene. And what's it doing for John? John's sitting right there. Well, even John, he sends messengers to him and say, you the guy? Could I possibly have been wrong about this? Well, no, you see, it was this concept of the kingdom and its nature that needed some adjustment. As we'll see, Jesus explains in a number of parables And he explains it elsewhere also, but he explains it in a number of parables, that the kingdom comes in two stages or two phases. Unlike this, the kingdom comes in two stages or phases. It is introduced or inaugurated. Then there is a period of time of unspecified duration, and then there's a decisive intervention when the kingdom is consummated or finalized. You see, it doesn't look like this. That's what they thought, but he teaches them that's wrong. That's what's messing you up. Two scholars, Preben Vang and Terry Carter, they state in their book, Telling God's Story, the biblical narrative from beginning to end, they say, according to Jesus, the kingdom of God is already here. Jesus inaugurated it. The age to come has broken into the present age. You see, this is the picture. You see, here's this old age, old order, this creation, and then it's been pulled. The age to come has been pulled into the present age. God is making his presence felt already, yet the kingdom of God is not here in full. Evil still exists. God does not yet fill all in all. This will only happen at the consummation when Christ comes back. We now live between the times. We now live in an overlap of ages, where the kingdom, the age to come, is a present reality, but it is not now the sole reality. It overlaps the old age or the old order. He says, we now live between the times. They say, we now live between the times. The promised age to come has already begun, but it is not here in full. The old age is still here as well. Many people have diagrammed this. Here's the way that David Wenham diagrams it. I've showed you this before. This is important, okay? And when I stumbled on this many years ago, as I think I've told you, I would have paid somebody to tell me this when I was a young Christian. I had to do an awful lot of rooting around to see something like this. And when I saw it, it was like one of these eureka things. So here is this idea. See, you have this kingdom of God as a present reality that is inaugurated by Christ. But we're now here in this overlap of ages. The old age and old order of Satan continues until Christ returns, at which time all that's contrary to the eternal purpose of God is stripped out, and the kingdom of God is the sole reality that goes on forever. You see, I like this. Now, text, in addition to the parables that indicate that the kingdom of God is a present reality, we'll see in the parables, and I'm going to go through those. But there are texts in addition to the parables that indicate that the kingdom of God is a present reality. You can see these texts, for example. See, both of these aspects, now and yet a future aspect. Now and not yet. See, already and not yet. Some sense already present, already broken into the now, but a fuller sense awaits. And you see this very same thing. You see it in these other texts. Just to mention two of these here in Colossians 1:13, God has delivered us from the domain of darkness and transferred us to the kingdom of his beloved Son. He's transferred us. We're in the kingdom. The kingdom is a present reality. You see? But it's in this state of overlapping. So the kingdom's a present reality. Revelation 1:9, your brother and partner in the kingdom. Hebrews 12:28, let us be grateful for receiving a kingdom. So there are a number of texts that, in addition to the parables, that show you the kingdom in one sense is present. It is already here. But then there are texts in addition to the parables that indicate the kingdom of God. There is an aspect to the kingdom that is still a future hope, both now and not yet. Both of those, you can see that. I've listed some of the texts here. You see that the kingdom is entered at judgment. You see this idea that the inheritance of the kingdom is something still future. So you get both of these poles in the parables, but you also see them in a number of other texts. And I've said this to you many times. This is very important for New Testament theology. You see, this is an important concept to understand, this idea of inaugurated eschatology, that the kingdom has been inaugurated, but it will be consummated. You see, this is significant because it doesn't just affect this. It doesn't just affect the Sermon on the Mount. It doesn't just affect the parables. It is an important theological structure of the New Testament. Very important. Okay. Now, this same and this same now and not yet aspect of the that characterizes the kingdom, you see it also characterizing other kingdom-related concepts. You see it characterizing other kingdom-related concepts. For example, eternal life. Do we have eternal life now? Yes. Somebody said, do you have eternal life? Yes, I do. Is there a sense in which eternal life is future? There is a fuller expression of yes. You see, so eternal life is now and not yet. It is present, but in a fuller sense, still future. You see this in all of these things. End of the ages. Well, it's now, in that one sense, right? But it's also still to come. And you see the text there. Redemption. Is redemption a present? Yes. Are you redeemed? Yes. Is there a fuller sense of redemption still to come? Yes. So you see it with redemption. Salvation. Salvation a present thing? Yes. Somebody says to me, are you saved? I tell them yes. You see? So, but is there a sense in which salvation is future? Well, yes. And here are texts indicating that. Still to come. Adoption. Are you adopted as a child of God now? Yes. Is there a sense in which adoption is still to come? Yes. And you can see the text that I've listed there. Death's defeat. Is it defeated already? Yes. You see, it's like D-Day. You've heard that illustration. See, where it's been defeated, but the actual realization of that defeat, it's just playing out. But it's dead. It's gone. It's defeated. The victory's won at D-Day. Okay, so that's that idea. So is death defeated? Yes. But is its defeat still to come? Yes, there's a sense in which it's still to come in the resurrection. That's what Paul says in 1 Corinthians. New creation, is it now? Yes, there's a sense in which the new creation's already occurred. What? That's been pulled into the now. This overlap, this is continuing, but I'm pulling this in. So is the new creation here? Yes, it's here. But is there a sense in which new creation is still to come? Yes. See, so all of these things are, it's the same idea. The kingdom is inaugurated, it will be consummated. These other kingdom-related concepts share in this same now and not yet aspect. Okay, I think it will help you in thinking and studying and reading and trying to integrate what you're reading in these various texts. Now, the inauguration of the kingdom, this involved a complex of events that are viewed as a single unit. The inauguration aspect of the kingdom. That is, it involved a complex of events that are viewed in Scripture just as a single unit. The kingdom was ushered in through the life and ministry of Christ, through His death, resurrection, and ascension, and through the outpouring of the Spirit on the day of Pentecost. That's why Jesus could say before the cross and before Pentecost that the kingdom has come upon you. And He could say that the kingdom is among you. You see, the process of inauguration was underway in the person and ministry of Jesus Christ, which is a process that would run through the events of Pentecost. So the inauguration is a complex of events viewed as a unit that includes His life, ministry, death, resurrection, ascension, outpouring of the Spirit. He, in that process, is inaugurating the kingdom. He ascends to heaven, and we await His return when the kingdom will be consummated. See, it's at His return, which began nearly 2,000 years ago, that redemption that He began. That redemption that He began nearly 2,000 years ago, when He comes back, it will come to completion. See, that's the time when in Revelation chapter 11, verse 15, the heavenly voices say, the kingdom of the world has become the kingdom of our Lord and of His Christ, and He shall reign forever and ever. How could you ever say has become? Well, it's in this sense I'm telling you. He's always reigned, always been sovereign, always there. But there is a sense, you see, when He comes and the kingdom is consummated, He is then asserting His rulership and His reign in this full, complete sense that everything is brought into harmony, the divine utopia. And that's what you see in Revelation 11:15. And that's the time when in Revelation 11, 17, the 24 elders say, "We give thanks to you, Lord God Almighty, who is and who was, for you have taken your great power and begun to reign." God began to reign? Didn't he always reign? Yes, he always reigned. But he began to reign in a different sense. He began to reign in this sense of asserting his sovereignty so that all that was contrary to his eternal vision was gone. It's in that sense, you see. Let me read to you a quote from Robert Stein. This is from the Evangelical Dictionary of Biblical Theology. Stein is now the professor of New Testament Interpretation at Southern Baptist Theological Seminary, but he writes this article in this dictionary. He says, "The kingdom of God..." I do this so you'll know that I'm not, you know... this is what I'm telling you is standard stuff. But if you've not heard it before, you go, "Is this guy crazy?" You see? Yeah. Well, I won't share that with you. I've had things said to me after classes that... all right, "The kingdom of God is both now and not yet. Thus, the kingdom of God is realized and present in one sense, and yet future in another sense. This is not a contradiction, but simply the nature of the kingdom. The kingdom has come in fulfillment of the Old Testament promises. A new covenant has been established, but its final manifestation and consummation lie in the future. Until then, we are to be good and faithful servants." This is how we're to live. But you see, that's the idea. Now, this expectation, this is what's behind Peter's statement, by the way, in Acts chapter 3, verse 20 and 21, when he says that Christ must remain in heaven until the time comes for God to restore everything. Well, we have creation over here, beautiful. What happens? Corrupt, all of this. He must remain in heaven until God's time to restore everything. It's his coming again. This is the consummation. This is the full restoration, the full healing of the creation that has been corrupted. He must remain there until that time. And it's the coming of the kingdom in this consummated sense for which Jesus instructed the disciples to pray, as I and many others understand it, in Matthew chapter 6, verse 10, where he says, "Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven," where he's asking us to pray for this finalization, for this consummation. It's at Christ's return that the children of God will receive glorious resurrection bodies. This is clear from Romans chapter 8, verse 11, Romans 8, 23, Philippians chapter 3, verse 20 and 21, 1 Corinthians 15. And not only will our bodies be transformed, we're going to have bodies. They're not going to be these bodies. They're going to be transformed bodies. They're going to be immortal. They're going to be so that something that's not perishable. They're going to be transformed so as to be suited for eternity with God. But not only will that happen, but all of creation will be transformed, as Paul indicates in Romans chapter 8, 18 to 23. See, this is the new heavens and new earth that you see mentioned in Isaiah, you see in 2 Peter, you see in Revelation. It's getting the ultimate makeover. This creation that has suffered as a result of sin's invasion, it too is being redeemed. Think of it as creation's resurrection. You see, as you and I will be resurrected, well, think of creation that way. And that is where we will live for eternity in the presence of God. N.T. Wright, I've mentioned it before, he's probably the best known theologian in the world today, that would be my guess. Wright says, "God made heaven and earth. At the last, he will remake both and join them together forever." This is what I mean when I use the phrase the heavenization of creation. This broken, sick creation is going to be heavenized. That's what he's talking about. You see, and when we come to the picture of the actual end in Revelation 21 and 22, we find not ransomed souls making their way to a disembodied heaven, which is how we've taught people many times. That is not the teaching of the church throughout the ages. Not at all. That is a Johnny come lately. Okay? But we've taught this idea, and it's partly this notion that we equate creation with bad. You see, it really has a Gnostic flavor to it. That is not the teaching of the church. That is not the teaching of Scripture. This idea that you're going to float off as a disembodied being and that's going to be your eternal state. No. No. That's an intermediate state. Eternal state is resurrection life in the new heavens and new earth. All right, he says, we find not ransomed souls making their way to a disembodied heaven, but rather the new Jerusalem coming down from heaven to earth, uniting the two in a lasting embrace. That's the picture of heavenization. It's right there. You see, that's what's being showed to us. This creation is being heavenized. Now, when Jesus said in John 18:36, his kingdom is not of this world. We have people, well, that means it has nothing to do with creation. That's not at all what he means when he says it's not of this world. He means that he's talking about the kingdom doesn't originate or derive from this world. That's not the source of his kingdom. It doesn't originate or derive from this world. It derives from God. So when he says it's not from the world, he's not saying it has nothing to do with creation. It has everything to do with creation. That's the story of the Bible. Why do you think you see the things reversed? You see the tree of life in Revelation. Why do you think we see the, over here? What's happened? We've got the tree. Then at the end, the tree. It brings the story together. You see, that's what's going on. This is not, let me read to you what Colin Cruz says in his commentary on John about John 18:36. He says, Jesus was saying his kingdom is given by God, not established by human struggle. His kingdom is active in this world and will one day come with power, but its power is not of this world, it is of God. That's the source and the origin. So we've some kind of missed this and have done things that from this text that I think are just not good. Now at his first coming, Jesus not only announced the kingdom's arrival, but he also demonstrated the kingdom's character. You see, Jesus has news, and the news is, what you have been waiting for so long, I'm the guy. It's here. It's me. I am bringing the long-awaited kingdom. There's no news like it. Sound the trumpets, baby, because this tremendous event is occurring. I'm the one. I'm bringing it, you see. But at his first coming, he didn't simply announce the kingdom's arrival. He also demonstrates the character of the kingdom. Illustrates the character of the kingdom. And he gives us a foretaste of it. John Piper, in a sermon he preached called Christ and Cancer, he says this. The answer to why Jesus did not raise all the dead. You hear that sometimes, right? Oh, I love these people who want to sit in judgment of my Lord. My absolutely perfect Lord, sinless, perfect, loving, giving, and I've got some, well, I got this against Jesus. You know, but they do that. Well, why didn't he do that? You know, he could have healed everybody. Piper says, the answer to why Jesus did not raise all the dead is that contrary to the Jewish expectation that I told you about, boom, boom, that's it. Contrary to the Jewish expectation, the first coming of the Messiah was not the consummation and full redemption of this fallen age. The first coming was rather to purchase that consummation, illustrate its character, and bring a foretaste of it to his people. Therefore, Jesus raised some of the dead to illustrate that he has that power and one day will come again and exercise it for all his people. And he healed the sick to illustrate that in his final kingdom, this is how it will be. There will be no more crying or pain anymore. Do you see what he's doing? He's showing elements of the kingdom. What's the kingdom going to be like? Sickness? Gone. Anything that causes sorrow, suffering, pain, heartache, alienation, any of that? Gone. You see, this is what he's doing. So he announces the kingdom. I'm bringing the kingdom. I'm the one. And he illustrates its character. You see, by doing these great works. That's why they're tied together. You see, that's the first bell? Ah, okay. That's why they're tied together. And just to round things out, I've said this a number of times. Let me say that I think we haven't been precise enough in speaking about the relationship between the church and the kingdom of God. I hope you can see from how I'm describing the kingdom of God that it is a larger thing. It is this dynamic work and rule of God. You see, the two are very closely related, The church are those participants of the kingdom, those who've entered the kingdom. But the kingdom is a broader concept. They're closely related, but they're not identical. And I think George Ladd captures this well in his book, New Testament Theology. I have in the notes that are online, you can see I have maybe four or five other people saying similar things about this. This is not a secret, okay? But here's what Ladd says. The kingdom is primarily the dynamic reign or kingly rule of God, and derivatively the sphere in which the rule is experienced. In biblical idiom, the kingdom is not identified with its subjects. You see, now you could speak of, he made them to be a kingdom. You could speak of the people who are the participants. You could refer to them as a kingdom. But you have to see that there are other aspects of the kingdom that go beyond that. Okay, so he says, they are the people of God's rule who enter it, live under it, and are governed by it. The church is the community of the kingdom, but never the kingdom itself. Jesus' disciples belong to the kingdom as the kingdom belongs to them, but they are not the kingdom. The kingdom is the rule of God. The church is a society of men, under God, of course. But I just want you to see there is something about, there's a larger sense. It is a bigger project. Now, the kingdom, the church is closely related to that, but I think it's a mistake to conflate them. In other words, to make them identical. I think that gets us off into some just bad territory. All right, next week, here's what I plan to do. I'm going to actually begin looking at the parables. Okay, so I just had to go through all this. I hope it's beneficial. As I said, I think sometimes just to reinforce some of these things, because I know how it is. I've taught many things different times, and I hear people say things. I'm going, well, I guess they didn't listen. But anybody who teaches has that experience. But we're going to begin looking at the parables, Lord willing, next week. And I'm going to present them to you in seven groups. You know, there's this question of how do you arrange the parables? And 3 weeks ago I was talking about it's hard to know. You know, how do you group the parables? So I've drawn my grouping significantly I've modified these things, but from David Wenham and from Klein Snodgrass's work on the parables, they were very helpful to me. But I'm going to present the parables to you in seven groups, all dealing with the kingdom, you see. The first set of parables will be Jesus brings the kingdom. And you will see parables. I hope that when you have a better idea of what I've been telling you about the kingdom, you will see how clearly the parables light up. They light up when you see Jesus saying these kinds of things about bringing the kingdom. You know, and so many parables are about the kingdom. And with this background, you'll be going, whoa, I hope anyway. I hope you'll have insight into the parables that you hadn't had before. So the first is Jesus brings the kingdom. The second category is the kingdom en route to the consummation. Parables about the kingdom prior to the consummation. The kingdom as present. The kingdom in the overlap. The kingdom in the here and now. And there are going to be a number of parables that I've categorized like that. The third one is the consummation of the kingdom. There are a number of parables that deal with the consummation of the kingdom. What occurs when Christ returns at the end? There are parables that deal with the kingdom being good news for the needy. That the kingdom, its arrival and what God is doing, that it's good news for the needy. There'll be a number of parables in that group. There'll be a number of parables in the kingdom is bad news for the establishment. And that's the truth. The establishment that wants to resist submission to the kingdom bringer, well, it's going to be bad news for them. And you'll see parables dealing with that. And then there are going to be parables that deal with the call to a kingdom decision. That is what everybody has to do. You know, whether you blow it off, that's all right. You've made a decision about it. Jesus has come into this world as a kingdom bringer, and he calls every person to choose. You must choose whether you will follow me or not. And so that's going to be one category. The last category is living as kingdom participants. He tells many parables about, well, how are we to live now that we have come in and said yes and we are participants of the kingdom in this overlap of ages? How are we to be? He tells many parables about that, kingdom ethics. That's what he talked about in the Sermon on the Mount. He has many parables. I heard that bell. Thank you for coming.